Please introduce yourself and what you do.
I'm Becky McMichael and I'm Head of Strategy and Innovation at UK comms agency Rudifin.
So what is your key objective for using social media, both from a personal perspective and a sort of brand perspective?
I think when I first started realising how powerful social media could be was when I moved out of London. So the kind of media industry is very London-centric, and to live outside of London and telecommute in kind of once a month or twice a month just isn't enough. You need to be much more present. So I started using social media basically to have much more of an online presence when I couldn't be there physically. Personally, I use it because my family is scattered everywhere. I've got two young kids. I am quite time poor, so I don't get a chance to read the Sunday papers anymore, in full like I used to. Professionally, I use it to be much more present in the industry and to network.
Right. And so what sort of routines do you have? I mean, do you sort of start every day by looking at your mobile, or do you have a set way in which you kind of get your news and how you publish? I mean, talk us through what you do.
I saw a funny infographic the other day where there was a working mum who reached for a phone and checked Twitter before she went and answered the mum that right. was coming screaming from the child's room, and I'm guilty of that on a couple of occasions. I tend to, in the morning, my basic routine is check Twitter. I use that pretty much in a way that people would use an RSS feed. So I check that for the headlines. I check any direct messages or responses.
What, on a mobile device or an iPad?
On an iPhone.
On an iPhone, yeah.
While I'm making the kids breakfast,
right.
basically.
Remembering to make eye contact with them. And
clearly. And then we all sit down for breakfast once I've done that. And then I will pretty much through the day go through RSS feeds, Facebook groups, my own blog, the company blog that I'm responsible for, at various different points through the day.
So do you set time in your diary to do that, or do you just do it?
I've done it for that long now that it's like you wouldn't put time in your diary to check your inbox.
Yeah.
So it's actually become that much of my working day. I don't use social media socially at work, just because I find it too distracting. So I don't tend to use Facebook during the day. I tend to log on to Facebook in the evening,
right.
Which is when I'll catch up with friends, family, upload photos or whatever.
And when you say social at work, do you have a social media, do you have a Yammer kind of thing here, or do you have a social?
We've tried, yeah. We use a couple of things. We've just started using Google Plus Hangouts a little
yeah.
bit more. Myself and my colleague in the digital team, we use a lot of our work we do collaboratively on Google Docs. You can now use Google Docs and Google Plus Hangouts. So we've started using that a little bit more. Skype all day, basically. I don't really make calls that much now. I tend to get people Skyping me from all the different offices, clients and stuff. So all of those tools would be used throughout the day, and to me they've really replaced the phone and email.
Right.
In terms of my working day.
Right. And so that's basically your device strategy. How would you describe that?
So device strategy, I have a laptop for work. I have a desktop Mac that I work on at home, a laptop that I bring into meetings and work on when I'm in the London office. I have an iPad that I use predominantly. The iPad is the one part of the device strategy that I really don't need. For me, it's mainly a media device.
Yeah,
I use it for watching videos on the, yeah. watching films on the train. I could completely live without it. I couldn't live without my iPhone, but I find they overlap
Yeah.
quite a lot, and I'll use whichever one I've got to hand.
Yeah.
But the iPad's invaluable for travel, because I download all the PDFs that I want to read into iBooks. So, when the reports come out from McKinsey or IBM and you never get a chance to plough through them, I save those up for the train. I don't have to lug loads of paper around.
Yeah.
And I don't like reading on an iPhone screen.
Right.
So, but really, there's quite a lot of overlap between the two devices.
So you find it quite easy to read on the iPad?
Yes, yeah, find it easy. The one thing I don't do is read before bed on the iPad, because I
right.
find it keeps me awake.
Right.
Yeah. the glare. Just,
well, they say that you
should. I started getting insomnia, and
they say that you shouldn't be online an hour before you want to go to sleep.
I don't know.
I've heard that from somewhere.
Reading in bed on the iPad doesn't suit me. I tend to use a paper book.
And so, in terms of social media platforms, I think you've covered most of this. But you know, Twitter's your main thing. Do you have them all integrated? You know, how are you managing that?
Initially, I started off without them integrated, so I had everything sort of siloed. Then a few years ago, when the sort of trend was to update your status once and ping it across your LinkedIn, your Facebook, your Twitter, I did that and actually didn't find that worked for me. So now I find that I've put each platform into much more context, so I have different uses for different platforms.
Yeah.
I don't bombard them with the same stuff. For example, Pinterest, which is the relatively new shiny player on the block, they've done a really good job, in my opinion, of actually making women become much more into curation of social media, whereas it was typically men who blogged, who used delicious bookmarking, and who gathered up and shared all that kind of business data. There's a much higher percentage, I don't know the percentage, but there's a much higher percentage of women on Pinterest sharing and curating data. So that's something that I personally use much more for home, so for things like recipes, and if I'm decorating my lounge, and I use it like a scrapbook. Like, I would traditionally have ripped bits out of a magazine and shoved them in the back of my diary. I think I've got a use and a context for each platform now.
Good. And in terms of blogging, what's your own personal blog? How do you manage that? Do you do it once a week? What's your strategy there?
Yeah, so my own personal blog's the thing that sits on my shoulder, haunting me daily, telling me that I should have updated it more often. I think it's the case for many people. So I, obviously working in an agency, I'm responsible for the agency blog, a number of client blogs, and my personal blog becomes, you know, the poor relation a lot of the time. So I tend to try and get blog posts stacked up for it. So I try and get 5 or 6 stacked up that I then set, that aren't time sensitive, that I then set for every 2 weeks. So I know that it's being updated relatively recently. And then I intersperse that with thoughts and things that are more current.
And what's your blog about? Is this the...
It's basically about being a balancing act between being a working mum and the PR industry.
Right.
And not living in London.
So. And that's separate from the other thing you do, which is this sort of women's network of marketeers.
Yeah, so that's more of a community initiative. Right. So that's another string to the social media bow.
Are you managing that all on social media then?
It's interesting. When we started it, the feedback we got from all of the members was that they wanted it to be an anti-social network.
Right.
So we started it with no online footprint whatsoever. Everything was sent out via formal, pretty printed invitations and thank you letters, and it worked really well for the first year. And then as these things happen, as it grew and grew, I guess the demographic of the people that were coming changed slightly, and there were more agency people and more online people who did find it useful to have social media. So we use a couple of things. We use Eventbrite to manage all the invitations, and we use MailChimp to manage the list. And we use the blog just basically as a holding page.
And do you do all that personally?
Do all that personally, yeah.
Right. So you're quite sort of technically proficient then at doing all this stuff, aren't you?
I mean, as much as I obviously kick myself every day that I didn't do a computer sciences degree, but I can build a WordPress blog.
Yeah.
I can, you know, set up basic, relatively basic Facebook pages, groups, that sort of thing.
And how's it going in terms of teaching people how to use your clients, you know, in terms of, you know, teach people how to get into social media? Are you still doing a lot of that, or is that?
Yeah, we are. I mean, I think it's a lot easier now than it was 4 or 5 years ago, because people get it. People know they've got to be there. There's much more of a willingness and a need to be doing it. So it's more, rather than selling the idea and the concept that it was a few years back, which was difficult, it's now training.
Yeah.
So it's now working on the strategy for it. And, you know, I think like any business, you don't embark on any sort of communications campaign unless there's a call to action.
Yeah.
And I think that's what people are realizing. The last 3 or 4 years, people just did it. So there was no measurement, there was no call to action, there was no kind of consideration about how it could negatively impact the brand. It's much more grown up now. Yeah. So we tend to back away from the, here's how you get on Twitter, here's how you tweet. You know, that's sort of gone, and we're now looking much more at, this is your business strategy, this is your business problem, this is how social media can benefit you as a channel. So it's grown up, it's become more strategic, I think, within the marketing mix.
Okay, so just final couple of questions. In terms of, you know, impact of digital and social on your life, I think you sort of said a bit about the location thing, but how would you sort of summarise what impact it's had on you in the last few years? And also, I suppose, where do you think it's going?
I think it's had a huge impact on me. I think one morning I came in, well, logged onto my computer at home, logged onto Twitter, and it was like walking into the office. So that's when it kind of said to me, this is such an enabler.
You could be anywhere.
I could be anywhere. Yeah. But beyond the kind of VPN and being able to physically work anywhere, I was with the team. Yeah. I was with the team, I was chatting, I could just have easily been at the coffee machine.
Yeah.
You know, and that was a kind of quite a profound change for me. In terms of where it's going, I think it's, you know, I've always believed it shouldn't be treated separately. It's a channel, you know, it's a route to your audience, or it's a, you know, it's a notelet, it's an email, it's a tweet, it's a Facebook group. Exactly.
Yeah.
So I think it's becoming more and more integrated. I think it's becoming cleverer. I think you know, the whole marketers have woken up to harnessing the social media data, I think there's going to be a slowdown just from the privacy side of things as consumers get more savvy.
Yeah.
About how they are now the product and their data is what is enabling offers and enabling everything else in the industry. So I think there will be changes, particularly for Facebook. But, you know, it's here to stay. And I think it's, you know, on the whole, used properly, it's a great, great tool.
Yeah. And finally, what is your top tip for people trying to go social or trying to get into it more?
My top tip is be really strict with yourself about having anti-social time. So make, whether it's half a day a month or whether it's one night out with friends, where you are really strict. The iPhone, we do something where the iPhones go in the middle of the table and the first person to check it picks up the bill. So actually unplugging is my best tip, because it keeps you fresh, it gives you ideas, and it lets you get your thoughts ready to do the next social thing.
Brilliant. Thanks very much.
Okay.